When it comes to providing food for an expanding world population, our seas are one of our most precious assets. And yet every year, we're pushing them further and further towards the brink of collapse.
It's an absolute desert. I just wasn't prepared for this.
Two-thirds of the world's fish stocks are considered to be overfished. There's no safe haven. The whole of the sea is pretty much up for grabs.
Oh my God, look at it all.
So I've launched a new front in my fish fight. I'm campaigning to set up new networks of marine protected areas in order to future-proof our oceans.
It's the only real answer for us to recover our seas.
So far, I've seen the damage that's done by destructive fishing methods both around our shores and further afield.
My God.
It's been dynamited so often that there are simply no fish left.
That's incredible!
And in Antarctica, I witnessed the threat that new technology could pose to the amazing wildlife.
Who wouldn't want to conserve this?
Tonight, I'm travelling to Thailand to discover how our love of king prawns is threatening fish stocks on the other side of the world.
It beggars belief. I mean, they're making a living by killing the future.
As ever, fish fighters everywhere can put pressure on our government.
I give you a chance here. I'm trying to fix this.
And our supermarkets.
We're put on hold again.
To take more responsibility for the health of our seas. Because if we all work together, we can make a difference that will last for generations.
Someone wants a ketchup, all right?
In Britain, we love our fish and shellfish.
Okay, thank you very much.
But the fish choices we make have a direct impact on the health of our oceans. Over the last 50 years, rapid advances in technology have made us better and better at taking fish out of our seas. The result is that all around the world, fish stocks are in crisis. Things are so bad that now we're catching smaller and less desirable species, not to eat ourselves, but to turn into cheap feed for farmed fish like salmon. And to feed to Britain's favourite shellfish, king prawns. We eat over 50,000 tons of them a year, from high-end premium products to budget ready meals and, of course, prawn curries. Most of our king prawns come from Asia, where they're farmed on an industrial scale. And what they're being fed on is a mounting concern, because it's contributing to the final depletion of these already extremely overfished waters. So I've come to Thailand, the largest exporter of king prawns in the world, to find out more. If you eat prawns and they're not organically farmed, then you're part of this global problem. And I'm hoping to find out how you can contribute to the solution as well. My guide and translator is called Mai.
Mai. Hi.
We're meeting at a prawn farm that's just about to bring in its harvest.
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
We're all right to go ahead and have a look around?
Yeah, right
and
now.
And do some
like,
filming?
Yeah, probably they're gonna like start with the feeding quite soon. So,
okay.
Yeah.
There are just 8 ponds here, but this is an intensive farm. Each pond holds around 500,000 prawns.
So this is the prawn feed going in first thing in the morning?
First thing in the morning, usually they do it in the morning, it's not hot.
How many times do they feed a day, do you know?
Several times, but I have to
It looks
to
like he's just finishing up now. I think his containers are empty.
Yes.
We've just caught the end of it. So are these the feed bags, Mai?
Yes, these are the feed bags that they are using to feed the prawns.
And do we know where this food comes from or who makes it?
We know that it's from CP, one of the biggest food companies in Thailand.
That's one of the biggest food companies in the world, isn't it?
Actually, yes. So it's like all the ingredients that they are putting into the feed.
That I'd like to hear about.
So ingredients, fish flour and also squid flour.
Not less than 32% protein, but it doesn't tell us the actual percentage of fish in here.
They never tell that.
That's kind of the sensitive information.
Yes. It's quite secretive in Thailand.
Really? Industrial espionage would be required to gather that information.
We need a James Bond.
You're looking at him. The James Bond of fish.
Yeah, probably.
It takes around 6 months for king prawns to grow to a marketable size. So twice a year, the ponds are emptied and the prawns are harvested.
So this must be the pond that's about to be harvested.
Exactly.
And these guys are getting ready to do the job.
Well, they have to prepare themselves quite well because the shrimps can be quite spiky.
They've got those pointed, really quite sharp spikes on the top of their heads, haven't they?
So the way that the local workers are using is actually wrapping feed sacks around their legs, tightly, as you can see.
Look at that, that's fantastic.
I'm keen to get to grips with every part of the prawn production process, so it doesn't take long before I, too, am being wrapped up in CP's feed bags.
I can see this providing some protection from the prawns, but these prawns can hop about all over the place with these little spikes at the front that are sharp. And from here upwards, I sense a little vulnerability, particularly in the groin area. Popcorn
crab.
Can I even stand up? My new party outfit, what do you think?
Once the sluice gate is opened, the prawns begin to pour out of the pond and into a holding net on the other side of a wall.
And where are they going from here today?
To Europe, to USA, to China, yeah.
Three continents, including Europe and the UK.
Yeah.
That's pretty spectacular.
Then the workers set about carrying 9 tons of prawns back up the hill.
Woof, that's heavy. They're coming thick and fast. This human chain is a very efficient way of delivering them up to the truck, but I've no idea how long this process lasts. I mean, is it going to be half an hour and a half, or are we going to be here all day? I just don't know. What's happened to him? Injury. Blimey. Okay. Might be time for a replacement. Okay. Blimey. I'm getting soaked straight away. It's a boiling cauldron of prawniness. Well, I better get on because the guys are waiting. I can feel the prawns popping within a few centimetres of my face. And I can feel the pricks going through my plastic leggings, through my arms. I just don't want to get one in the eye. Ooh! Ow! Ow! God, this is a tough job. I'm already knackered. It's like weightlifting in the gym. Only wet and sharp. Ooh! Ow! That was a pathetic netball there. Gotta do better than that. I never really stopped to imagine the process of harvesting. I had no idea it would be like this. It's manual work, but it's an industrial process. Ah! I'm absolutely shattering. Ugh. I'm out of here. Ugh. Blimey. It's weird because when you see king prawn on a menu, you think luxury. But this is really the crustacean equivalent of intensive chicken farming. This is very, very high volume, industrial process. The end product isn't cheap, but it's being consumed in huge quantities, and the market's growing. And the more the market grows, the more the demand for the feed to raise these prawns in these ponds. And that's where the squeeze is. That's where the real problem is now environmentally.
Although the exact recipe of each company's prawn feed is a closely guarded secret, we do know that the industry uses a lot of what has come to be known as trash fish. I want to find out what that actually means and where all this trash fish is coming from.
I've managed to hook up with one of the local artisan skippers, Nerud, and he's taking me out to try and find one of the trawlers who we think is catching a lot of trash fish.
We've come just an hour or so outside Nerud's fishing village.
Where we are right now, among these islands, and in fact within 3 kilometres of the coast, is a marine protected area. The trawlers are not allowed in here.
But pretty soon, we come across a trawler inside the reserve where it shouldn't be fishing, preparing to haul up its nets.
This is a spur of the moment thing. Nehru's just literally called them up on the radio, explained that we're out here, that we're filming, that we're looking to see what they've caught. So the question here is, are they going to let us on board? Right, it looks like they're preparing for us to come alongside.
You have to
really hurry. Sawadee kap!
Sawadee kap! You really have to
hurry. Sawadee kap!
It's almost time for them.
Yeah.
They cannot wait.
Okay, guys. Sawadee kap! Here we are. Here we go. Here it is. I can hear the flapping of fish, and this is the mesh. It's incredibly fine. Really, you can barely get the tip of your finger through that. Here we go. Here we go. And that's our catch. I mean, basically, what this looks like is that they've caught everything. I mean, look at that. That's an indication of the mesh size being used. If a fish as small as that doesn't get through, then basically nothing gets through. There's a puffer fish here that's decided to inflate itself, probably got quite upset to end up in a net. And there's little blue-spotted stingray there. These are all different species of jack, tiny baby fish, which I'm imagining could have grown up to be 1 or 2 kilos, but they're not going to get there because they've already been caught. It beggars belief.
Although there are a few fish big enough to be sold at market, more than half of this entire catch is considered to be trash fish. It's destined for fish meal. Anything left is either too small or unprofitable, even for trash fish. It's thrown overboard dead. Scientists have estimated that these seas are being overfished by almost 250%. That means the boats here are taking out 2.5 times as many fish from the sea as it can possibly sustain. Most of the big fish here have already been wiped out, and the fishery's close to a total collapse.
Another trawler's come alongside.
And these marine reserves are supposed to be the very areas where recovery can begin to take place. But with so little enforcement by the authorities, the trawlers fish here as if it were any other part of the sea.
Let's be clear, these guys are just trying to make a living. But, I mean, they're making a living by making a killing of the future of the sea. There are thousands of fish here that could have been left to grow on to big marketable size and feed hundreds of people. But that's not their destiny. Their destiny is the feed mill. And from there, they're going to feed pigs, chickens, prawns, some of which might end up in a supermarket or a restaurant in Britain. And it all started here in the middle of a national marine reserve in Thailand.
I've come to Thailand to investigate the link between our love of king prawns and the devastation of these hugely overfished waters. I'm convinced that to give these seas a chance to recover, we need to put pressure on the people who control the fishmeal industry. They need to commit to using only sustainable and legally caught fish in their animal feeds. So, together with my guide and translator, Mai, I'm trying to find out where some of the trash fish being caught in the local marine reserve is ending up. We followed a truckload of it to a local fish processing plant.
And we have a truck here, or a couple of trucks. There's There's fish in the trucks.
Me, 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 me.
Oh my God. There's a lot of very, very tiny fish and all sorts of little things, crabs, some sardines, but also a lot of juveniles.
This plant sells to several companies, including CP, the biggest producer of prawn and animal feeds in the world. The trash fish is mixed together before being fed into a series of ovens and dryers. As the fish passes through the production line, it gets progressively drier and finer until it emerges at the end as powdered fish meal.
So this is the final stage. A finished bag coming out right now.
This plant produces two different grades of fish meal. Today's batch, which is a lower grade, and a separate, finer quality meal, which has more protein in it, and is called shrimp grade.
And this is for shrimp? So she might sell this to CP for their shrimp feed?
Yes, she is also selling them for shrimp feed or CP.
The chain of supply for feed milling and then prawn farming and then prawn distribution has been quite murky, but it's slowly coming into focus for me. And I think what I've established here today is that CP is using illegally caught fish in its feed. We don't know if they're feeding it to prawns. We're pretty sure they're feeding it to pigs and chickens. But they're using it, and this is a massive company that British supermarkets are doing business with.
I'm not sure whether a big multinational company like CP know that illegally caught and juvenile trash fish is being used to make their animal feeds. But before I put it to them, I thought I should have a look at some of their products. And guess where I found them on sale.
Just been doing my Tesco shopping here in Thailand. Apparently Tesco are massive here these days. Look at it. CP chicken. CP pork, CP shrimp, 1 ton. These guys are producing for the masses. And not only do they sell the pork, the chicken and the prawns, they sell the feed to the farmers who produce the pigs, the chickens and the prawns. They own the whole system. They control agriculture here in Thailand. You know, if these guys do the right thing, there's a future out there of sustainable seafood. And if they do the wrong thing, there isn't. It's kind of all over pretty soon. How do I feel about taking them on? I don't know. I mean, they're only a few times bigger than Tesco, and Tesco talked to me in the end.
So I decide to give them a call.
Hi, is that the CP press office? Hi there. I'm just wondering how I could arrange an interview to talk to somebody in CP about prawn farming and prawn feeds. I've been put on hold. My name's Hugh Whittingstall. I'm travelling in Thailand looking at prawn production. I've been put on hold again. No, I'm still here. I haven't gone through yet. Oh, they have their own, the prawn people have their own communications department, do they? I was just given her name by one of your colleagues. No, but can you give me the correct email address? If you're asking me to send an email to get the interview, surely you can give me... I'm sure you don't have any email address called to whom it may concern.
I'm not getting anywhere with CP's Bangkok office, but a quick Google shows me that they also have an office in the UK.
Good morning. Is Helen Meppam there, please? I'm trying to arrange an interview. It's Hugh Fernley Whittingstall here. She's got a meeting with Tesco at the moment, has she? OK. Thanks, Fiona. Bye. That felt like progress. That felt like, yes, we know who you are, we think we know what you might be calling, and we'll see what we can do. Interestingly enough, she's not in the office at the moment. She's at a meeting with Tesco, who Fiona volunteered to tell me they supply a lot of prawns to. So there we go. No secret.
In the hope of getting an interview before I leave, I've driven 7 hours north to Bangkok, where CP have their headquarters.
So this is the main wholesale fish market, is it, Tang?
Certainly one of the big ones.
But with no word back from them, I've arranged to meet up instead with Simon Funge-Smith, the senior fisheries officer at the United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization, which monitors all the fishing activities in Southeast Asia.
Wow, this must be nearly half a mile from one end to the other.
Yeah, this is supposed to be the largest fish market in Thailand.
The Billingsgate of Bangkok.
Possibly the Billingsgate of Asia.
Oh, look at these guys. So there are some big fish left in this system.
Yeah, look at the state of this guy. He's a big cobia.
Some barracuda and big red snapper and grouper.
Yes, I would assume these are not even being caught here. They're probably being caught further away towards Sabah and Indonesia.
And you're divining that pretty much from the size, because you're pretty sure that fish like this don't really exist in these waters anymore.
We have them, but they're not a huge part of the catch. I mean, certainly for Gulf of Thailand, we're looking at a fishery that's basically fished absolutely at its limit. And the first species that you start to get less of in the catch are these very large, high-value, bottom-dwelling fish. Yeah, here we go. This looks much more like the very low end of the catch.
My goodness.
Yeah.
So this is not, I assume, for human consumption.
You wouldn't catch me eating this.
A lot of it.
Yeah, something like 25% of the marine catch ends up in this sort of low-value grade, because this will be turned into fish meal.
But in terms of long-term sustainability, is it wise to be catching all these small fish and turning them into fish meal? I mean, some of these are the potential future stocks of these oceans, aren't they?
That's right. We're losing diversity when we see this in a fishery. And that's important, particularly in tropical fisheries where we have so many different species interacting.
How formalised and effective is the fisheries management in Thailand? I mean, what sort of measures for stock conservation have they got in place?
There's a 3-kilometre reserve zone for the artisanal fisheries. Unfortunately, it's not that well enforced, and we have a problem with trawlers operating in that zone. The problem we have is simply when you have 79,000 vessels in a fishery, you can't watch all of them.
The sheer scale of the problem seems overwhelming, and I'm certainly not going to be able to change things on my own. But if we can make the heads of the prawn feed companies aware of the problem, I think there's a chance that we can use public pressure to inspire change.
Hi, Caroline. It's Hugh Fernley with Hughs.
For the rest of my time in Thailand,
we're close to Bangkok now, and we're here for a couple of days.
I keep chasing CP for an interview.
Hi, Fiona. It's Hugh Fernley with Hughs again.
But to no avail.
I'm surprised that your company, with the reputation you have, you're unwilling to come on camera.
Yeah.
So on my return to the UK, I'm keeping the pressure on.
I've written to CP 3 times now. I've addressed or copied in 5 different members of their management, including the UK boss, Bob Miller. I finally had a reply. And perhaps the most notable thing about it, straight off, it's not actually from anyone. It's anonymous. It's signed, Best Regards, CPF Corporate Communications and Public Relations. Here's what they have to say about the sustainability of using trash fish and the possibility that some of it might be illegally caught. With regards to fishing in Thai waters, Department of Fisheries of the Royal Thai Government is the competent authority in regulating such activities.
And they go on to say that because their fish meal suppliers are supervised by government authorities, they are complying with the law.
Which is basically another way of saying, if illegally caught fish is ending up in our feeds, it's not our fault, it's all down to the Department of Fisheries in Thailand. That seems to me to be an extraordinary attitude.
I reckon my best chance now is to try to get some of the British supermarkets who buy CP's products to engage with the issue.
Dear Tesco, dear Co-op, dear Morrisons.
If we can get them on side, then maybe they'll use their buying power to persuade CP to take more responsibility for the health of our seas.
I would really like to speak to you on camera about how consumers can be sure that their prawns are having a minimal impact on the environment, and about the Co-op's relationship, and about Morrison's relationship, and about Tesco's relationship with CP Foods.
Depressingly, The supermarkets don't seem to want to talk about this either.
First, Tesco told me that they would give me an interview, and then they said they wouldn't. And when we asked them why, they said, there's not a lot to say about this at the moment.
But then they sent me this statement. We are committed to ensuring sustainability across our supply chain. Reducing reliance on fish meal is a complex industry-wide issue, but we're actively looking at how best to tackle it.
Morrisons have also refused to talk to me on camera. They said it would be difficult for us to discuss these issues in a broadcast interview.
The co-op said, we are currently investigating the issues raised with our supplier.
We are committed to sustainable fishing and responsibly sourced fish. But they also said, we do not have anyone available to talk to you on camera about prawns. I'd say that's a bit of a contradiction.
Now, I'm hoping that if you fish fighters out there get involved too, we might actually get some answers on this issue.
You can bet representatives of these supermarkets are watching this show right now, waiting to see what we're going to say about them. Well, if they won't talk to me, maybe they'll talk to you. So let's get tweeting. What are your prawns eating? At hashtag fishfight. You can send that to at UK Tesco, at Morrison's News, and at Cooperative Food.
We started sending tweets on this earlier today, but now it's time to get serious.
Let's get Fish Fight trending during this commercial break.
Great work, everyone. Look how many tweets we've sent. The supermarkets will have to respond to that, and we'll keep you updated on our website, fishfight.net. Of course, overfishing is not just a disaster in Asia, it's a problem all over the world, as two of my favourite fellow fish fighters can attest. Greenpeace Oceans campaigner Willie McKenzie has joined the crew of their boat, the Arctic Sunrise, in West Africa. They're here to document European boats devouring the fish stocks off the coast of Mauritania.
We found ourselves right in the middle of a whole host of these big factory trawling boats, Dutch, German and other vessels.
One of these massive boats is even registered in Britain.
This is it. This is the biggest ship in the UK fleet. Look at the size of it. I mean, that's more than twice as big as the Arctic Sunrise we've just got off. That's longer than a football pitch. We can catch hundreds of tons at a time. I mean, sustainable fishing does not look like that. And when you think that something like this can be catching in a single day, what many, many single little African fishing boats could be catching over a whole year, you can see the scale of the problem. This is just us in Europe exporting our problems to other parts of the world.
Meanwhile, my River Cottage colleague and mackerel campaigner Tim Maddams has been in the Northeast Atlantic investigating the so-called mackerel wars.
That's it, we've got the line over on our boat. Once they've winched it in, they'll pull up the cod end, attach the pump, sink the pump into the water and pump all the fish out. Sounds easy.
2 years ago, Tim campaigned hard to take the pressure off cod and haddock by putting mackerel on the menu in over 600 fish and chip shops across the UK. And it was a runaway success.
It was absolutely delicious.
That's actually really nice.
Beautiful.
But things are changing. A failure to agree quotas between Iceland and the Faroe Islands on the one hand and Norway and the EU on the other means that even these mackerel stocks, only recently considered sustainable, are now under threat.
That is a lot of mackerel. Look at it all. I mean, it's a fishing method. It's impressive, you know. There's nothing else here. The quality is incredible, but... you know, I'm not sure how catching this many fish on one boat can be sustainable.
The Marine Stewardship Council have decided the prospects for mackerel in the Northeast Atlantic are so worrying that they've suspended their certificate of sustainability. And until there's a political solution to these quota wars, the future of sustainable mackerel fishing, and indeed our mackerel BAP, is in serious doubt.
That's more mackerel than I ever expected to see in my lifetime, that's for sure.
Whether it's huge ships overfishing the open oceans, or damage done by trawlers and dredgers closer to our shores, I realise that it's just not realistic to try and stop these destructive fishing methods altogether. But I believe that setting up many more marine protected areas is vital if we're going to provide protection for our marine habitats and offer the chance for our fish stocks to recover. And there are a few places in the UK where marine protected areas are already proving their worth by excluding the most damaging forms of fishing and allowing the natural habitat to recover. I've come to one of the largest MPAs in England, just a few miles from River Cottage. Marine biologist Emma Sheehan is taking me out to sea for a closer look.
We're heading out into Lyme Bay, and there's been a lot of focus on marine conservation in this area. What's actually been happening here for the last few years?
For 20 years, there have been people who are trying to protect the reefs in Lyme Bay. But since 2008, we actually had a statutory instrument, and it's called the Box locally. And we're actually in the middle of it now. It's 200 square kilometres. And in that area, you can't tow any fishing gear.
So in this box, there's been no beam trawling, no scallop dredging at all for 4 years now.
Yeah, but you can still go in there, you can hand pick scallops, you can set pots, you can set nets.
And today we're going to go out and look for signs of recovery on the reef.
Yeah, that's the plan.
Hope we find some.
Yeah, me too.
Long-standing Lyme Bay fisherman John Walker takes us into the middle of the box. It's been closed to scallop dredgers and beam trawlers for over 4 years now. But some fishing is still allowed here, provided the fishermen use only static gear like gill nets and lobster pots. We're hoping that Emma's underwater cameras will give us a better look at the sea floor.
Okay.
Have you got this spraying?
Yeah, I got it.
The stationary baited camera should attract resident species on the seabed, while a second flying camera will give us a good idea of what the seabed looks like now that scallop dredging and beam trawling have been excluded.
Ah, very James Bond.
Okay.
Lights and everything.
Yeah, so we're just going to lower it in, so it should just fly along quite smoothly, even though we're bouncing around all over the place.
When I see a lovely smooth shot on the monitor in that wheelhouse, then I'll believe you. What's your first rapid assessment of the sort of seafloor condition that we're seeing here, Emma?
It's looking fantastic. We've got these sponges and all this growth on the rocks. These Ross corals that we're seeing, they look like they've almost doubled in size, which is fantastic because that's such important habitat for the small larvae, juvenile fishes to hide in the Ross coral so they can get out of the elements and also hide from predators.
So once you've got a good rich marine habitat, then the fish start coming back.
This is the basis of this healthy ecosystem coming back.
And sure enough, Emma's baited camera seems to be attracting a variety of fish species.
So here we've got a female cuckoo wrasse at the back here. She's just disappearing. And in comes a nurse hound. There's pouting who was attacking the bait box.
That's the wrasse, isn't it?
That's the male.
There's a crab here.
Edible crab.
And he's porcod.
Yeah.
Plenty of fish going on.
We're only 4 years since the closure, and yet we're seeing such benefits. Scallops and crabs and fishes.
Lyme Bay is starting to feel like a real success story. Mm-hmm. How does it feel to see this recovery happening?
I think it's the best way, and it's the only real answer for us to recover our seas.
John, you're a fisherman. What does it mean to you to see this recovery? Do you read it the same way as Emma?
Absolutely. There are fish on the ground now which we've never seen before. Red mullet, bass, of course, turbot, brill, a nice lot of monkfish, and we've never had those for years.
John's not the only Lyme skipper enthusiastic about marine conservation, especially since a group of local fishermen supported by the Blue Marine Foundation are now actively involved in the management of their MPA.
Cheers.
Cheers, everyone.
I caught up with them in a Lyme pub.
There has been a fairly instinctive reaction on the part of
a lot of the fishermen around the country to be very, very wary of MPAs generally. And in other areas, that's still the case.
I personally was highly sceptical, but then once you find that whether we liked it or not, there were going to be conditions imposed, we have got a marine protectorate, we have to live with it. So the best thing we can do as fishermen is make sure we're the ones in control of it.
But from your feel for where you're at the moment, is it making a better living for more local fishermen than 10 years ago?
Yeah, most people are doing as well, probably doing a bit better. Yeah. Than they were before.
If we get this right in the coming months and the years ahead, who will feel the benefits of well-run MPAs?
Everybody.
Future generations.
I mean, everybody, not just fishermen, but the whole country's going to see it. We hope that this is going to be the start of something that we can actually say that we as fishermen are actually conservationists as well.
We're investing in the future. We just can't take everything out to sea ourselves. We've got to leave something for future generations to come along. And this is the start of doing something for that, isn't it? Surely.
I'll drink to that. Cheers.
Cheers.
Fishermen talking positively about marine protected areas. That's got to be good news. And here's some more. Conservationists, scientists, fishermen and other sea users have been working together to come up with a new network of protected areas around England called marine conservation zones. It's taken over 3 years and has cost £8 million so far. What they've come up with is 127 sites designed to protect important habitats against the most damaging forms of fishing. But some powerful voices in the fishing industry are coming out against the full network of sites, and we still don't know how many of them our Fisheries Minister Richard Bennion is going to approve and with what levels of protection. Many fishermen say the process is being rushed. They're worried that trawlers and dredgers will just be displaced to other areas. They also claim there's not enough evidence that all the zones will do the conservation jobs they're designed to do. I understand these concerns, but to me and many who've worked on the proposals, the burden of evidence is the wrong way round. The situation is too urgent for yet more delays. We need to protect the most vulnerable habitats now and then gather evidence on how well that protection is working, both for conservation and for fishermen.
I find everything quite nerve-wracking at the moment. You know, there is this big conversation going on about marine conservation, big enough so that there are now 127 marine conservation zones that are being proposed. But it's tantalising because we don't yet know what's going to happen. So right now, we need a fisheries minister who's going to show some backbone. Take this flak and then push on and do what's right. So come on, Mr. Bennion. Man or minnow, have you got what it takes? Let's see some action.
Since I started making this series a year ago, I'm delighted to say that all around the world, a large number of new marine protected areas have already been designated. In June 2012, the Australian government announced that they want to protect 2.3 million square kilometres of ocean, roughly equal to a third of its enormous marine area. A few months later, the Cook Islands announced that 1 million square kilometres will be managed as a national marine park. And the state of California have completed a network of 124 sites which cover a massive 16% of their state waters. But closer to home, things are not looking so rosy. When it comes to marine protection, we're lagging seriously behind. And new proposals for 127 marine conservation zones around England are facing strong opposition from parts of the fishing industry. So I've come to meet the man in charge, our Fisheries Minister Richard Bennion. As a supporter of the proposed ban on wasteful discards, he's proved he can hold his own in Europe. But how's he doing at protecting vital marine habitats here in the UK?
Hi, it's Hugh here to see Richard.
When I first met him at Billingsgate Fish Market 2 years ago, he was at pains to reassure me that he would deliver on his promise to give us more marine protection.
What do you want to be able to look back and say 3 years from now?
We put in place an ecologically coherent network of marine conservation zones, the kind of marine protection network. That's something we can all feel proud about.
A year later, in Brussels, he was pushing the same message in the same words.
We will have an ecologically coherent network of marine conservation zones around the coast of England, and it'll be something that everybody can feel proud about.
So I'm hoping that this time he'll have something new to tell me about how much of the sea he's going to protect and in what time frame.
There are 127 sites under discussion. They've been presented to you on your desk over a year ago. There's a lot of anxiety at the moment that there is considerable doubt and backsliding over the initial commitment that's been made.
There is no backsliding. I absolutely refute that. The point is that I will have ensured that on our watch we will have implemented the Marine Act, and that means that we will have an ecologically coherent network that people can feel proud about.
Got that. Well, I've totally got it.
Well, I actually believe in bottom-up governance. I believe in fishermen sitting down with conservationists and boaters and other interests and actually coming up with a plan. I think that's the right approach. What we have at the moment is roughly 22% under some form of management. We will have
0.001%. 0.001% are fully protected.
Well, I give you a chance here. I'm trying to fix this. I'm trying to implement an act which was brought in before I came into office. I'm trying to do it as quickly as possible in a way that won't get legal challenge, that will be ecologically coherent, that will satisfy marine conservationists.
I'm getting all the buzzwords, but I'm not getting any hard stats. You're absolutely reluctant to commit to anything in terms of percentages or square kilometres.
Let's just get this right. Don't get too hung up on percentages. What I'm concerned about is protecting the right environments on the basis of sound evidence, and then having really rigorous management procedures in place that does it in a way that ensures it's sustainable for the long term.
Talk about banging heads and brick walls. I mean, that is the same conversation I had over 2 years ago in Billingsgate. It's so frustrating. And the only sort of silver lining is that, you know, there's this time frame now where we can get very vocal, get a load of support on this issue of marine reserves, so that when he does make his announcement in a year's time, it's what we all want to hear. Lots of marine reserves, real conservation. I'm starting to talk like him now. Should we just go back? Our films are almost done now. We're at the very end of our edit, and I've just heard the most staggering piece of news. Richard Bennion has announced that his department is only going to consider 31 of the 127 marine conservation zones. I mean, all year they've been talking about 127, and suddenly 96 of them are kicked into the long grass with no time frame attached. You know, now is the time where we have to protect the sea from the most damaging forms of fishing. If it's not done right now, it's going to be too late.
The government has asked to hear the public's view on MCZs. So, with my friends from the Marine Conservation Society, we've organised a march and a rally.
What do we want? MCZs! When do we want them? Now!
We're going across Westminster Bridge, straight to the Houses of Parliament.
I've no idea how many people there are behind me, but it feels absolutely fantastic. And I think it shows just how much feeling there is about this issue, and how much we want to grasp this opportunity. When do we want? 127! When do we want them? Now! I'm delighted to say that there are enough of us to have the road closed. 127! No!
It's just brilliant that so many people have turned out in the cold to support marine protection. They just keep on coming and coming.
We're all here today because we believe in the sea. And we're also here because we've got a problem out in our oceans.
We know aggressive and damaging forms of fishing are making scars on our seabed, are tearing up sensitive habitats. We have to stop doing this. So we're here to ask our government to be bold and be ambitious and create a new network of marine conservation zones all around our coast, one that our children and their children can be grateful for. Marine conservation zones are not the enemy of our commercial fisheries. They are the friends of our fishermen. There is a time frame here, and the clock is ticking. There are 34 days left only on this consultation. You need to get online. You need to talk to DEFRA and to the government. And we are making that marvelously easy for you with our website that's now live behind us. And I'm delighted to say that 10,285 of you have already written to DEFRA. Some of you have got smartphones on you right now. You can get online. We can see that number going up. Let's ring up our friends. Let's get people to sign up and get involved. We can make serious changes happen. Changes that will make a difference to our oceans for generations to come. What do we want?
1, 2, 7.
When do we want them?
Now.
What do we want?
MCZ.
When do we want them?
Now.
So let's see what people power can do. I'll be back later in the year to update you. And in the meantime, keep fish fighting.
Next Thursday from 9, was it a flaw in its design? Was it sabotage or was it a bomb? What destroyed the Nazi-funded Hindenburg? Well, next tonight, what upset the Financial Services Authority, Dave and his community bank, the obstacles it's had to endure, coming up here on 4. We'll be right back.